Some of my first experiences as an engineer came digging holes in sand at the beach. I remember being so upset that as I dug deeper and deeper, the sides of the slope would collapse in on themselves. When slopes here at the Kalgoorlie Super Pit collapse, we lose a lot more than a few minutes of progress. Our story begins in 1893, when prospector Panay Hannan discovered 100 ounces of alluvial gold in what became known as the Golden Mile. The mile is actually a 5 kilometer long, 2 kilometer wide, and 1 kilometer deep stretch of 1,000 particularly rich ore seams, located about 600 kilometers from Perth. Soon, tents and rough sheds grew into the booming gold rush town that is Kalgoorlie Boulder. It wasn't long before surface deposits were spent, and miners needed to head underground in order to access those particularly rich seams of gold. By 1903, 49 operating mines existed in the Golden Mile, with tunnels extending more than 3,500 kilometers. Tunnels are a good way of getting you to the deposit and extracting ore, but unfortunately leave a lot of potential gold in the surrounding rock. This was fine in the early years, but after nearly a century of tunneling, it was becoming too difficult, dangerous, and expensive to continue. It took mining visionary, patron of the Australia 2 racing yacht, and reasonably corrupt businessman, Alan Bond, to realize how to make the Golden Mile profitable once more. He started buying up all of the old mining leases, consolidating them together into what became known as the Kalgoorlie Super Pit. Peering into the pit, you can start to appreciate what a truly mammoth undertaking creating it would have been. The step sides fall steeply to a depth of more than 600 meters. Trucks worth $4 million roll past with their 200-ton payloads, slowly making this mine even deeper. In May 2018, two mammoth rock slides occurred over a 12-hour window, which temporarily suspended all work in the mine. You can see the slips on the eastern wall spilling over the roadway. Even today, there is an exclusion zone around the collapse, reducing operation and leaving thousands of kilograms of gold inaccessible. While there are plans to remediate the problem over the next few years, the long-term solution is to stop future rockfalls from occurring in the first place. One cause of 2018's collapse was the presence of a pre-existing fault, which runs the width of the mine. Old mine shafts too need to be accounted for, and you can see some of these as dark patches on the walls. Another factor we need to account for is the interplay between soil cohesion and slope steepness. Soils with really low cohesion are those we find around the rim. Sandy red stuff which falls apart really easily. That's why the slope around the top has to be quite shallow, with an angle of about 45 degrees. On the other hand, as we go deeper, sand turns into rock, and this rock has a much higher cohesion. Near the bottom, we can get angles of close to 90 degrees. You might think the best option is to go for really shallow sides, making the mine as safe as possible. But as it turns out, as you get deeper and deeper, that's a lot of wasted material, which comes at extensive cost to the operator. A much better idea is to make the slopes as steep as possible given the circumstances. But how steep is too steep? In the past, the solution would have been to take a sneaky look at your neighbor's mine and assume you can get away with doing something similar. But today's engineers have a much better solution, using computer simulation and the finite element method. Here is a model that some friends and I made for a unit last year. It's a 2D cross-section of a slope. 3D would also work as well, but the computers we're running it on are a little bit slow. We begin with geologists taking core samples of the area that we're trying to mine. We then simulate this in the computer program. For example, here we have a fault line, while up here is some soft sandy soil. Taking these, we can then cut in some different slopes. This one is 30 degrees, but we can also try out with different angles, 45 degrees if the 30 is proven safe, or 20 degrees if it's too steep already. How it works is we take a really big, complex object and break it up into thousands of individual finite elements. These are simple shapes like quadrilaterals, which we can easily convert into a matrix form and analyze how they interact. For example, we can include properties like stress strain and weight characteristics, performing some really basic matrix operations to work out how they interact. The more elements we have, the better our results. However, the simulations also take much longer to run. So I set up the entire library computer room, running different iterations of our code, each with a slightly different slope angle. On a lonely Friday evening, I spent 14 hours setting up different simulations, working on our report, and drinking an unhealthy amount of coffee. In the morning, these were some of our results. We could analyze them to work out when and where the failure occurred. For example, on this 43 degree slope, we have failure at the base. The bottom bit would have just gone to mush. On the other hand, at 44 degrees, we have a face failure. The whole front of the slope would have slid into the bottom. Finally, we then calculated a factor of safety, essentially how safe each of the slopes is going to be. A low factor of safety of 1 or less means that the slope is very likely to fail. If you have a high risk tolerance and don't really care about your workforce, you can get away with quite a steep slope angle, say close to 50 degrees. On the other hand, if you have a low risk tolerance, then you're going to want a shallower slope. It's more expensive, but you're also less likely to kill your workers. You might want an angle of 30 degrees. Unfortunately, even our most detailed models can't predict everything. So in addition to running some really advanced simulations, operators perform constant monitoring of their slopes. Lasers let them know of any millimeter scale shifts, which could warn of an impending collapse. Step sides helps catch any small rockfalls before they turn into a full-on avalanche. It's also possible to shore up weak zones using concrete retaining walls and rebar supports. For more than 130 years, Kalgoorlie's Golden Mile has been turning children digging holes at the beach into engineers searching for buried treasure. But how do we turn these mineral ores into the metals which run the modern world? It's an amazing story of engineering, but one which we'll need to wait for another episode. Until then, this has been James Dingley from the Atomic Frontier. Keep looking up.